Let me introduce myself. I am an investigative journalist working in and on Afghanistan for the last 15 years. And today, I want to blow a whistle because I think, instead of being neutral, war reporting is promoting war. It's still difficult for me to say, but let me explain you why I say this. In 2006, I went to Afghanistan for the first time. I expected a very complex story, how to report on death and life, on a conflict with 52 Western countries fighting, with so many parties involved. I always thought journalism in war is the most difficult job you can do. But I saw something different. Many journalists actually reported on one side of the story. We all went embedded and landed on these camps with thousands and thousands of Western soldiers sitting behind high walls. Of course, there is critical war reporting on the military. We talk about civilian casualties, airstrikes that went wrong, or secret prisons the CIA was running, or maybe is still running. But we never spoke about why are we at war. So this made me think, I have to leave this bubble. I have to go on my own to Afghanistan. Colleagues in this camp said to me, don't go, don't go. It's very dangerous out there. It's hell on earth, generals would say to me. But I left all these camps because there were a couple of freelance journalists already who traveled alone. We didn't hear them, but they were there and they helped me. And what I found when I went on my own was shocking, because it turned out it was very easy to go to Afghanistan. It's very easy to book a flight to Dubai and to fly with an Emirates flight, if you like, if you have the money, to Kabul, the capital of Afghanistan, a capital of 4 million people, a normal city with a lot of normal daily life. When the taxi driver picked me up to bring me to the hotel with a beautiful rose garden and no barbed wire, I was like, the terrorist is so much stronger in my articles than it really is. There was access everywhere. Afghans were helpful, knowledgeable. They could bring you wherever you wanted, to the desert of Kandahar, to the president of Afghanistan. We relaxed a lot. This is the lake just outside of Kabul. I met friends for life. This is in Kandahar. Of course, I did reporting. But what I did see, that there were also other journalists who lived my life. CNN, New York Times, Washington Post, but also Europeans. I clearly remember the moment that they went live. They stayed in my hotel with their rose garden, remember? They put on a helmet, wore a vest with press, and started updating about the war, about the last attack, about the Taliban, about Al-Qaeda. And I was like, what? They were serving the editors on the other side in the West. They were not serving the public. Because if you do, you say the last attack was 3 months ago, and oh, we have no idea who actually did that attack. It could be the mafia of Kabul. They did not report that we all had sushi the day before. And we drove there in a Toyota for $4. For a long time being in Afghanistan, I thought maybe this is the only error we have as mainstream news reporting. Maybe this is only Afghanistan because we just don't know enough about this country. It all happened to us after 9/11. I am now in academia as well, and I study this subject, reporting on war. And it's not only Afghanistan. Us interviewing mostly Western sources, but also more or less embracing that story only has happened before. There's been good reporting on the Vietnam War, but there's also been tremendous mistakes. Why did we go to war in Iraq, in Vietnam? Google the Tonkin incident, 1964. The US made up a reason to go to Vietnam, to start the war. This you won't read in the mainstream media. This you only now and then come across in opinion pieces. There's the Gulf War in the 90s, another example, where the US Army and the US government tell horrible stories about the Iraqis killing Kuwaiti babies. It turned out that statement was false. This is not covered. We went to war, we marched with the US troops to the Gulf. I think you might know what is the next example. The next example is from 2003. The next example is the lowest moment in our history of reporting on war, I would say. Because that's when we reported on how the US wanted to go to Iraq. The US government making a story of Saddam Hussein being very closely linked to Osama bin Laden. Saddam Hussein having the weapons of mass destruction. I don't need to tell you, I think we all remember. The good thing is, the New York Times apologized. Some maybe would have hoped some soul searching, some reorganization in the newspaper business, but let me break the news for you. That didn't happen. The 15 years of Afghanistan have told me now that we also need to apologize about how we reported this conflict. Let me mention three examples of where it went horribly wrong as well. First, we killed a peace deal as mainstream media. After the Taliban was toppled, in December, they surrendered. They were powerless, they went home. They didn't want to fight anymore. They supported the US-supported government in Kabul. This was news for 24 hours, and then it disappeared. Because then there was a press conference in Washington, D.C., where the US government announced that nothing is happening against our will. We wrote that down. Also, we do not talk to the Taliban. We wrote that down. Also, we're going to send troops because there's an ongoing global war on terror. We also wrote that down. If you Google the surrender of the Taliban of 2001, you won't find a lot until today about this. Another mistake we made is that we pointed at the wrong enemy in Afghanistan. If you have no enemy, but you do double the troops, who are these troops going to kill? Or who are these troops going to capture? They did take action every day. They went out of the bases I showed you, tried to capture the Taliban. But what you don't know is that behind this narrative, there is the story of false reporting. In a complex society, where you pour weapons into, and you ask the local governor, where is the Taliban? then there is also an answer coming that comes from other dynamics, from rivalries. There's a lot of important tribal leaders. You have to understand this concept. The tribal leader has a conflict that's very old, a family feud, or the tribal leader lost land because of a rivalry. Or the tribal leader is actually a warlord and is heavily involved in drugs. Now, the man is also the governor and is asked by the super powerful US Army, where is the enemy? He points to you, a valley, go and kill them. Too often, the US Army did not check or cross-check. Eager, trigger-happy, emotional about 9/11. But in the first 4 years, and I still find it difficult to say, we killed the wrong people. Another mistake we made. The most wanted of the US government, and also, of course, the NATO and the European Union, they all followed the US Army. The most wanted of them has become our most wanted. I researched Mullah Omar, the number two of the most wanted in the world, after Osama bin Laden, for 5 years. Don't go, they said, he will blow yourself up the moment you will come close to him. I thought, let me give it a shot. It was much easier to find information about him. There was lots of people who met him, who knew him. And slowly, slowly, I started to understand that the monstrous image the US Army had communicated to us, but also that we had accepted by writing down again and again as a long echo of the insurgency leader living in Pakistan, who has a daily basis control about suicide bombers sending them to the US forces and killing them. It turned out to be different. If we all would have done these interviews, we would have known, maybe by 2004 already, that he had actually surrendered, that he had moved just in the same province inside Afghanistan, and basically became non-active. He didn't organize it. He lived on a walking distance from the US base. Now, it's important, I think, to think about the solution, though it's not easy. We've had examples and examples for inner reflection on News Desk on how to improve this, how to just include more sources. I do have 3 suggestions. And when I discussed this TED Talk with my CNN colleague, he said, just keep in mind, the essence of news is fastness, because our readers want to know every day what's going on. And like, what did that bring us? In the last, let's say, only the global war on terror, which is now 20 years old. That brought us fast food, ugliness, easiness, fat, unhealthy stories. Not even that, it promoted war. It could have been peace in Afghanistan. Because we want fast, we rely always easily on people who speak our own language, the Western sources who we share so many things with. So let me see if we as editors of News Desk can become top chefs again, take back the big responsibility of our profession, which is a balanced story, which is distance towards every government, towards every terrorist. Propaganda comes from all sides, not only from Moscow or from the terrorists. First of all, I would, and it's never going to happen probably, but I would love to see that all these news desks of big media like Reuters, AP, AFP, The Washington Post, The Wall Street Journal, The New York Times, and yes, it's mostly American that dominate our agenda, that they would actually sit together, make a separate page, and say, we cannot change the war. People have died. But we do want to do a cross-check on what we've told you. And we do want to do a check on this bias we have towards the Western sources. By now, It's almost common knowledge that the Taliban surrendered. Big authors in the US have been written about it. Diplomats have apologized. So there is room. There's room for this massive, massive rectification. Another thing is that I would like to suggest to choose and find ways to have better ingredients for our story. That means reorganizing, probably not with so much extra money, but just reshuffling the people we have. Why is everybody working in Washington? Or in Europe? If we talk foreign affairs, it's not only there. Foreign affairs is the whole world. So that means we also need to have 5 to 10 people in Tehran. Because isn't that a worry? What is the US going to do with Iran? Are we journalists ready for a conflict like Iran? Look at the coverage we have now. How many people are reporting from Tehran and from here? It's a dangerous balance. And maybe I should finish. And I do know that nothing is going to change easily. But maybe there's just one call I would like to do on all the correspondents around the world covering this conflict. Embrace the complexity. Take your time. There will always be a newspaper who wants to be first. Ignore it. It's fast food. It's tasteless. Just be strong and say the basic facts. And for the rest, #I don't know yet. Thank you.